as you're watching Old Faithful for the last few minutes before an eruption, we would like to tell you a bit about this video. A small group of scientists from the California Institute of Technology, Arizona State University, and Yellowstone National Park have been studying how Old Faithful works in detail. We are especially interested in geysers since they seem to work in very similar ways to volcanoes like Mount St. Helens, yet we can safely work around Old Faithful. Some time ago, we made measurements of temperature and pressure at several depths down the vent of Old Faithful. We collected data starting from the time that it emptied out at the end of an eruption until it refilled and finally erupted again. From this work, we learned many details of how geysers work. But of course, we still have many questions. We'd like to know where the water comes from. Does it come from the sides or from the bottom or both? Why does it stop filling up at about 15 feet below the top? If you look down from the top, the vent is a slot about 4 or 5 feet long and about a foot wide. You can see down about 10 feet. But below that, we really don't have any idea what the vent looks like or what effect its shape may have on the way Old Faithful erupts. We wonder if the vent fills with water quietly or if it is boiling. Old Faithful also makes a series of big splashes before each eruption. You have been seeing these in the video. In fact, an especially large one usually triggers off the eruption. We don't really understand what that's all about. These and many other questions have led us to want to see what's down there. Just recently, it's been possible to get a very small television camera. We have put one of these cameras in a metal housing to protect it from the boiling water and to keep it cool. With it, we have been taking video pictures down into the throat of Old Faithful. We thought you might like to see them. As Old Faithful again throws a big bunch of water out, this time it probably is going to start the eruption. And indeed, that's the case. There is Old Faithful in full eruption. Here you see that Old Faithful's surface vent is a slot-like structure, as I mentioned before. It's covered with a material called sinter, which looks kind of like snow, but it's actually made out of silica, a very hard material that coats everything that gets splashed with the erupted water. The housing we built for the camera is seen in this view. It's a stainless steel thermos bottle with the camera on the inside cooled with ice. It's attached to the surface by a long cable. You can see the white 1 foot markers on the cable. Here we are testing the lights needed to take video pictures down the dark vent. Here is the little camera itself out of the housing. It's about 2 inches long and about 3/4 of an inch in diameter, lens and hole. We now have the camera down into the vent of Old Faithful. It's about 6 feet down, and it's swinging on the end of its cable at the moment. And we will soon be on our way down to as deep as we can get safely. At this moment, we're still discussing exactly whether all of the hardware is working and if we have the camera properly hooked up electrically and the right microphones running and all those sorts of things. We want to make sure we've done everything right before we go in because we have no idea what's going to happen. You can see the near wall of the vent in the bottom left corner of the picture. The top right hand is in sunshine and it's overexposed. And here we go, down the vent. And you can see it's still a slot. Down as far as we can see so far. It's really quite a narrow slot, just a few inches wide. You also see occasionally drops of water falling down. You'll see those as we go along. That's water that's condensing from the steam in the vent on our cool housing. Those drops are very convenient, actually, because they tell us which way is straight down, which we otherwise wouldn't know. And we didn't really plan it like that, but that's the way it worked out, which was very convenient. We're dragging most of the time along the side of the wall. Notice at this point we can see some fractures and cracks in the sidewalls, although the sidewalls actually look very smooth, and that's because they're covered with the sinter material that we see up on the surface. Notice now that there's lots of water coming from down below. It's very tiny little droplets that are being blown up with the steam that's coming up from below us. And now you can see we seem to be coming to kind of a shelf-like structure, and we worry about whether we're going to land on that and not get off of it. And we bang into the surface of it and kind of bang up and down a little, and aha, we go over the edge, which is very nice. But here's yet another one, and this time you can see a pool of water down there. And because of the droplets, we know that we're going to land just to the side of that little pool of water. There seems now to be a lot of water coming down around us from the sides, which is not coming from our housing. Now we're landing on this flat little platform of rock and banging up and down. And folks handling the cable at the top now think that they're okay, but actually the camera is laying there on that shelf and the cable is just going on down the hole below it. Now since we can see it, why, we can tell them that that's the case, and so they will start bringing the cable back up now to pick up the camera and see if we're lucky and can get over the edge of this ledge somehow. We've known about this ledge from our measurements before and always wondered what it might be. In fact, we thought it was probably a narrow place in the slot, but in the picture as we were coming down a moment ago, you could see that it really was just a flat shelf. So we have some good chance that we'll be able to work our way over the edge of it somehow. So at the moment, you see lots of water, by the way, moving down around the camera. Aha, here we've come off of the ledge and we're banging around again. And now it looks as though we've gone over the edge. So we've been lucky and got past this ledge. And we're down into a much bigger open area now. You can't really even see the far side wall quite yet. And now suddenly we see something very striking, which is was a big mystery to us as we were watching this in real time. It's clearly just wildly boiling water, which is boiling up and splashing all over the camera. We had not really intended this camera to be in submerged in the water, and so we were quite concerned about this, and we actually stopped at this point and came back up a little bit to think about what we were seeing and watch it a little more. And we did realize at that point that what we were seeing was this wildly boiling water. But we really didn't think that was a good thing to put the camera down in. So we decided that we wouldn't go down any further, that we would start back up, and we would go up somewhat slower so that we could see in more detail what was we were going by and what the walls of the vent really looked like, and see if we could see water coming in from the side and other things like that that we were interested in. Also, this would allow us to measure the dimensions of the vent because we had calibrated the camera in the laboratory so we could actually make measurements of sizes of things. Here you see us going back up to kind of the side of that platform that we landed on a bit ago. We're actually going up about a foot at a time, waiting for a few seconds so we have a chance to see things pretty well, and then going up another foot. Now you can see our puddle of water again and see where we actually landed from the drops of water from our camera. We see large amounts of these drops of water coming in seemingly all directions, not only from the bottom, but also we seem to see some coming from the sides. As we move up, we occasionally come out into an open area and we swing as we are doing now, and that gives us a view of a little wider area than when we're dragging along the sidewalls of the vent. You can see that the picture sometimes gets a little fainter That's because we had to adjust the lights as we went up and down, and as, of course, when we got close to the wall, then we had to turn the lights down to keep from overexposing the video, and then as we got out into the big open areas, we had to turn them on more intensely. We didn't do that very perfectly. Notice, by the way, in the bottom right-hand corner, you can see a waterfall falling down the side. Seems to be coming from kind of in underneath this slot. It's not very much water, so we don't think that that's a major source of the water that's filling the vent. Now we're back up into really quite a fairly narrow slot, and we seem to have gotten up above so much splashing and other things. However, occasionally, as just then, you see fog. That's because the wind is gradually getting a little higher up at the top, and it's blowing down into the vent, and that allows fog to form as it cools the steam in the vent. And you will see that occasionally as we go along when a gust of wind causes some air to get down in the vent. The vent is full only of steam normally, and the steam is quite clear, fortunately, otherwise we wouldn't be able to see much, because everything is at the boiling temperature of water, so you don't get a fog of steam as you do out of a chimney or something like that. Big blast of water right then coming from down below, continuing at some level here. It's gets onto the window of the camera and makes the image a little bit fuzzy. There's another blast of air. We've stopped now. We're about 11 feet, and we've stopped now to decide what we are going to do, whether we're going to give up at this point, thinking that we're lucky and we didn't bust our camera, or decide whether we want to get brave and go back down again and see, now that we understand better what's going on, see a little more details about that. And so we decide, in fact, to go back down again. We have an awful lot of nice video there, and if somehow we do the camera in this process, well, we tried. And we have a lot of information that will keep us busy for quite some time. So now that we kind of know what to expect, we'll see and recognize things better than we did the first time down. Notice how very smooth the walls are. That's the center coating everything. There's our waterfall again, really quite striking in the right-hand side of the picture. But really, there's not very much water in that. And you can see there are little puddles of water all over that shine in the lights. And now we can already see the top of the boiling water. It's coming very much higher up into the vent than it was when we were down just a few minutes ago. We've come to our little shelf again, and the first of the little shelves, and we bang around on it again, and we managed to get by it. Notice, though, that there's lots of water boiling around. It's turning the camera around. There's our shelf where we got stuck last time, and we have to worry about whether it's going to get stuck again. And sure enough, we do. The camera is now not moving. But then suddenly something happens, probably a big splash of water from the wild boiling, and kind of knocks us off of the shelf. And now we've gone down a little ways, and we really are seeing the wildly boiling water and water pouring around us in all directions. And looks like a tornado now and again as it twists the camera, spins the camera around on the end of its cable. We really became very concerned whether our camera is going to survive all of this. It certainly wasn't made with that in mind. Never had any idea that we were going to be involved in anything so wild as this. Notice the big blast of water from the sidewall at that time. That was a lot of water, but it was just a sudden burst. So we don't really know whether that's one of the sources of water for filling it that somehow doesn't run in a steady way, or whether it's just water that splashed over the edge and kind of off to the side and is now running back in. We're coming back up again slowly, coming up a foot and waiting 2 or 3 seconds, and then another foot. And every once in a while we get this completely drowned in water and foam, and you can't see anything at all. We're coming up again now on the little shelf, and notice how much water is running down the side of it now. Clearly just from the splashing of the water in the wild boiling. Things really are getting very much wilder as we are down there this time. The vent is clearly filling up with water. We're still about 20 or 25 minutes before the next eruption, so we're not concerned that we're going to suddenly get caught in an eruption, which I'm sure the camera would not survive. So what have we learned? We didn't see an obvious large source of water, so we think it must be coming from below 40 feet somewhere. We also saw no side channel that would explain why the vent doesn't fill up above 15 feet. We'll need to watch what happens when the water level actually reaches that depth to understand what's happening there, I think. We saw that the vent continues as a slot down to about 35 feet and then opens up to a bigger shape, and that helps us understand somewhat how the eruption works. We found that the filling process is certainly not a calm activity, and we now understand the pre-eruption splashes. They're just the top of the wildly boiling water as it nears the surface. Clearly there's much to be learned using this downhole camera. We hope you enjoyed looking down into Old Faithful with us, and we'd like to thank the folks from the Yellowstone National Park for permission to put our camera in Old Faithful and for assistance in doing so.